Awesome. Thanks, John.
Thank you.
good morning and welcome to Gloria Day. If you are here in person, and also those of you who are worshiping with us online, there's a QR code in front of you. If you wouldn't mind scanning that this morning for a wealth of resources, worship resources to help guide you in your worship today, and also for those of you who are online. This morning, we had the privilege of having a children's message. So at that time in our service, the children are welcome to come down for a special time of worship as we continue to worship this morning. Let us worship again and continue singing again. And as I say again, how great thou art.
Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God, our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sin.
Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you by thought, word, and deed. Wherefore, we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy, seeking and imploring your grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O merciful God, who has given your only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us. And for his sake, grant us remission of all our sins. And by your Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will and true obedience to your word, to the end that by your grace we may come to everlasting life.
through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy upon us and has given His only Son to die for us, and for His sake forgives us all our sins. To those who believe on His name, He gives power to become the children of God and has promised them His Holy Spirit. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, Lord, unto us all.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is your health and salvation. Let all who hear now to His temple draw near, joining in glad
as we read responsively from Psalm 145. I will exalt you, my God, the King.
I will praise your name forever and ever.
Every day I will praise you.
And extol your name forever and ever.
Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise.
His greatness no one can fathom.
My mouth will speak in praise of the Lord.
Let every
be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Living God, continue to send your Holy Spirit to renew and restore us. We pray that the fruit of the Spirit is nurtured in each and every one of us so that we may share your good news in ways that all people will understand and believe in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Good morning, my friends. How are you? How many of you love a really, really good story? Me too. Well, I'm going to tell you a story today about my grandpa. Have I ever told you about this story about my grandpa? Oh, I had a really, really great grandpa. How many of you have a really good grandpa? Oh, this grandpa was so awesome. In fact, every time we would go visit my grandpa, we'd pull into the driveway, and before my dad even had the car in park, we were jumping out of the car, running up the stairs, and the door to his house was always closed, even though he knew we were coming. And behind that door, we always knew our grandpa was standing. And we'd knock really hard, and he'd fling open the door, and he'd take his arms really wide. He had super, super long arms. And he would grab each one of us and he'd say, "Oh, there's my girl. There's my boy." And he'd lift us up and he'd swing us around. And then he had this really big, oversized rocking chair. And we'd all sit on top of Grandpa, and he would tell stories, and we'd ask him questions, and he would hug us, and he always, always said to us over and over again, "I love you fiercely." Isn't that a great story? Ah, I love that every time I think of my grandpa. Well, today we're going to hear about a story that Jesus told his disciples. He oftentimes used stories to make a point. He had been praying, and when he had finished praying, his disciples said, "Jesus, teach us how to pray like you pray." And so he taught them the Lord's Prayer. We say the Lord's Prayer every Sunday morning, and it's the prayer that he taught his disciples. And then he went on to tell this story. Just like we knocked on that door and we knew behind that door our grandpa was standing. He said, "Go to God and knock and ask and seek and spend time with him." And he loves to tell you over and over and over again that he loves you fiercely. And I can imagine when we come to God and we seek him and we talk to him and he talks right back with us, I imagine he flings his arm really wide and he says, "Oh, there's my girl. There's my boy." Isn't that a neat thought when you think about that? Well, Pastor Randy's going to talk a little bit about that and the time that Jesus told the story about. Like, go always, always knock on God's heart, seek him, ask him always. He loves to tell you over and over again how much he loves you. That's pretty cool, isn't it? Well, let's fold our hands and bow our heads and let's thank God for always opening his doors, always opening his arms, always opening his heart to us. Moms and dads and big people, will you pray along with us as well? Dear Lord, we love you so much, and we know, Lord, that you love us too so much that you want us to knock on your heart and seek your heart and ask you things because you love to open your arms and tell us how much you love us. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. You may go back to your seats.
A reading from Psalm 34, 15 through 22. The eyes of the Lord are toward the righteous, and his ears toward their cry. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to cut off the memory of them from the earth. When the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. He keeps all his bones. Not one of them is broken. Affliction will slay the wicked, and those who hate the righteous will be condemned. The Lord redeems the life of his servants. None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 11th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
And he said to them, which of you who has a friend will go to him at midnight and say to him, friend, lend me 3 loaves, for a friend of mine has arrived on a journey, and I have nothing to set before him. And he will answer from within, do not bother me. The door is now shut, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything. I tell you, though he will not get up and give him anything because he is his friend, yet because of his impudence, he will rise and give him whatever he needs. And I tell you, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened for you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks it will be opened. What father among you, if his son asks for a fish, will instead of a fish give him a serpent? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We confess what we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
We continue our worship with our offering this morning. If you are a first-time guest, please check in by scanning the QR code there in the pew in front of you. And I'm going to invite Derek to speak about our Masterworks concert coming up.
So Gloria Day, next Sunday at 5 p.m. in the chapel, we have a special opportunity for you to join us in what we call a Masterworks concert. It's a worship concert. There will be worship. It is a service, but we're using concert music to help us get along that way. This next song you hear, Psalm 23, a great setting of Psalm 23, will be featured in that Masterworks concert next week. So hopefully today this might be a teaser to help invite you next Sunday at 5 p.m. in the chapel for our annual Masterworks concert. Ushers, I invite you forward.
Maketh me to lie down in green pastures. is my shepherd.
Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. My name is Randy Miller. I'm one of the pastors here at Gloria Day, and we find ourselves in a series about the parables of Jesus, the stories that Jesus shares in order to communicate spiritual truth in our lives. And so I'm going to kick us off with a story. I want you to imagine that you're in your house and you're hearing kids next door playing in their backyard. And they just moved into the area, they're fairly new, and you're just building the relationship with the family. And they're in their backyard, and they're playing with their dog. They've got this green tennis ball, and they're throwing it, and the dog's chasing it and coming back with the ball, and you can hear just a lot of fun happening in their backyard. Isn't that picture so cute? I looked for a long time. This is a perfect picture for this. Just adorable. Right? So this is a really touching scene. It's a really wonderful scene with kids playing in the background and you're inside your house taking care of different tasks and things you're needing to do. All of a sudden, you hear something where this ball just travels. There's this oomph underneath the ball. It goes over the fence and it lands in someone's backyard. And not just anyone's backyard, your backyard. The kids are a little scared. Again, they're new to the area. They don't know how you're going to respond. They love to get their ball back so they can keep playing with their dog. So they go to the door, and they're daring each other to knock. And they play a book from the Christmas story. They triple dog dare each other to knock on your door, and they nervously knock. How will you respond to this inconvenience? Will you yell at them? Will you bring up your Ring app through the video and tell them to go away? You go to the door and you begin to open it, and as someone who calls Gloria Day their spiritual home, this is your moment, this is your opportunity. You get to shine because you get to be an everyday missionary to help these children live fully alive in God's grace. And they explain what happened to you, and they're so apologetic, and you tell them to wait right there, and you go out to your backyard, you retrieve the tennis ball, and you hand it to them, and they're so thankful, and you wish them a good rest of their day. Not a big deal. So imagine that same scene with the same people, the same dog, but not at 5:30 at night after school. Imagine that at 2 a.m. 2 a.m., your neighbors are playing in their backyard. The music is blaring. The dogs are barking. You hear a tennis ball hitting the side of the fence with an audible thud, and you're thinking, what is going on? And as someone who calls Gloria Day their spiritual home, being an everyday missionary and helping these children live fully alive in God's grace is the furthest thing from your mind. They are driving you nuts, and you just want to go back to sleep. It's so incredibly rude what they're doing. How could they be so inconsiderate? Who would be so self-centered? And that's the frustration, and that's what's going on in today's story that Jesus shares with us. He's telling a story that is so absurd and so outlandish that he's getting our attention about a spiritual truth. And one of the areas in our spiritual life that this story is going to hit home on is our prayer life. So I want to begin by asking you a few questions about your prayer life. How would you describe your prayer life right now, as it stands today? Is it good? Is it so-so? It could be a little bit better. Is it just scripted and you're going through the motions? Maybe you're frustrated because your prayers seemingly aren't being answered, and so you're on the verge of just giving up. Maybe your prayer life and your conversation with God is just completely non-existent. You don't even know how to pray. Or maybe you've decided to outsource your prayers and let other people, like pastors and others, pray for you on your behalf because they must pray a lot better than you do. Or maybe you're unsure and you're asking yourself these questions: is God even listening? Does he even answer my prayers? Does he even care what's going on in my life? Maybe your prayer life couldn't be better. You were so relieved. You got that grade you needed to go on to the next grade. You got that diploma a few days ago. Oh yeah, your prayers were answered. You successfully completed school in another year. So no matter where you're at in your prayer life, the parable that we're going to walk through today is going to apply. And so with all that as a backdrop, I invite you to turn with me to Luke chapter 11. And if you're using the Bible in the pew ahead of you, you can find that on page 869. And in this story that Jesus is going to tell, it is so outlandish, it is so bizarre, that he's telling us something to get our attention about our prayer life. So we'll be looking at Luke chapter 11, beginning with verse 5. And Jesus is going to begin with a loaded question in the way he asks it. And he's going to lead us down a path in a certain way. So in verse 5, he says, "And he said to them, 'Which of you who has a friend will go to him at midnight and say to him, "Friend, lend me 3 loaves, for a friend of mine has arrived on a journey and I've got nothing to set before him."'" So let's pause there. Think of your friends, and think of if your friend came to your house at midnight and knocked on your door and asked for 3 loaves of bread, what would you say? I don't know about you, but I would say that is really bizarre. That is really weird. And it's not even knocking. Maybe they text you in the middle of the night. They send you a text and they say, "We need 3 loaves of bread." And you're scratching your head thinking, 3 loaves of bread? Who has 3 loaves of bread in their house? That is so weird. And what makes me laugh about this story is how your friend pitches this to you. He says, "Lend me 3 loaves of bread." And I'm thinking, how am I going to lend you 3 loaves of bread? Like, I don't want it back after you're done with whatever you're doing with 3 loaves of bread. How are you going to borrow it and return it to me the next day? So you would respond the same way the person that Jesus is telling the story to would respond. So bizarre. And the story continues in verse 7. And he'll answer from within, "Don't bother me. The door's shut. My children are in bed with me. I can't get up and give you anything." So the friend would say the same thing you would, flat out refusal. This is so bizarre. "Don't bother me. You're not only bothering me, but you're bothering my family. We decided to have a camp out in the living room, so my kids are there on a sleeping bag and a fort made out of all these pillows. I'm sleeping on the couch, so if I go to the door, I'm going to disturb them and risk waking them up. My animals are already a mess because you knocked on the door and disturbing them. I'm trying to keep them quiet. They're on high alert, and you're at the door asking me for 3 loaves of bread. What are you doing?" It's so incredibly rude. Who could be so inconsiderate? Who could be so self-centered to demand 3 loaves of bread? What Jesus is saying, though, in this culture, is that it's better that the friend embarrasses himself by waking up his other friend asking for 3 loaves of bread than to go back home with nothing in his hand. And when Jesus says, "Which of you has a friend who would do this?" he's asking us to imagine the unthinkable. He's asking us to imagine something so absurd. And he's saying all of this to make a point. Here in verse 8, "I tell you, though he will not get up and give him anything because he is his friend, yet because of his impudence, he will rise and give him whatever he needs." So at the end of the day, the door opens, 3 loaves of bread appear, and the friend takes those and provides great hospitality to someone he's hosting. And Jesus says all of this happened not because they were friends, but because of his impudence. Now, there's a triple word score for Scrabble, impudence. I had to look that one up. I'm like, what does that word even mean? Impudence means it's an outlandish activity, Someone has audacity. They have no shame at all. It's like if someone were texting you and you put your notifications on and it comes through on their phone saying their notifications have been silenced. Do you want to notify them anyway? And they just spam that button and they just blow your phone up even though you've got your notifications silenced. That is shameless. That is what Jesus is getting at over a request that is so bizarre and so weird at midnight. Jesus launches into the spiritual truths about this story in the following verses, verses 9 and 10, very familiar words. And I tell you, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, it will be opened. Have you heard these words before? Very, very familiar words. They're talking about our prayer life. And just reading these two verses out of context without any idea of what's before and what's after could leave us really dangling with our prayers. The cancer diagnosis that you've been asking God to intervene and heal, it's still there. And in fact, it's even getting worse. And you're wondering, is God even listening to my prayers about my health? Or you're seeking God's wisdom on a big decision, but you've received no guidance yet, no clarity about your next step. Or you're banging down God's door to get your answer for your mission and purpose in life about a situation maybe that's out of your control and you've got no guidance. And because you've got no answers, you're left thinking, did I ask hard enough? Did I seek long enough? Am I knocking on God's door loud enough? And you're thinking that your prayers are dependent on you. And Jesus is sharing this parable and those spiritual truths to address those issues, those struggles in our prayer life. When prayer is something that we're trying to get God to do something on our behalf. What Jesus is saying here is that prayer isn't bothering God into submission. Prayer isn't saying, God, you're holding back on me, so I need to get your attention so you shake some things loose in my life. Sometimes in our prayer life, we try to pry answers out of God's hand, thinking he's unwilling to give us those answers, or that he's dangling good things over us and that we have to be good enough or say the right words in order for those good things to come into our life. See, when we don't have any words left, when we don't know what to pray, when we're wondering, what is God up to? God is so generous. God loves us so much. Jesus shares in this story that he gives us so many good things. He gives us the Holy Spirit. A few verses in Romans chapter 8, when we're wondering what to ask in prayer, look what God provides. The Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we don't know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches our hearts knows what's the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for us according to the will of God. That's totally amazing. And when we are seeking God and we're asking him for answers, look at what he does in Ephesians chapter 1. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and you believed in him, you were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. And when we're left knocking on God's door, wondering if he's on the other side, wondering if he's going to ever open the door and answer, look at what he gives to us in 1 Corinthians 12. Now, there are a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are varieties of service, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who empowers them all in everyone. In all three passages, when we're asking, when we're seeking, when we're knocking, God gives us the Holy Spirit. Today, on this day, we culminate our Easter celebrations on the day of Pentecost, the day when we celebrate when God gave the Holy Spirit way back in Acts chapter 2 and created this movement of God's grace and his love, and that he is so near that the Holy Spirit points us to Jesus and his sacrifice on the cross and his death and resurrection for us to conquer all of our fears, to repair that relationship that was broken before our Lord, and the Spirit who gives us the gift of faith and strengthens our faith. Jesus is leading up to this moment when he talks about the Spirit. Before he gets there, look at what he says back to Luke in verse 11. He asks another outlandish question, another silly question to get our attention. What father, what mother among you, if his son asks for a fish, will instead of a fish give him a serpent? Or if he asks for an egg, we'll give him a scorpion. In other words, what parent, when a child asks for popcorn, would give that child marbles? Or a parent, if a child asks for fruit, who would give them cotton balls instead? Jesus is getting our attention. No one would do that. And so here's how he lands the plane in verse 13. If you then, who are evil, that's a whole nother sermon, if you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Jesus culminates this story with the Holy Spirit, that the Holy Spirit is what's given to us as this generous gift from God to strengthen our faith, to ask God in prayer for things that we don't know what to ask for, to help us seek him and see him in our everyday life. When we're knocking on his door, as Audrey mentioned, to see that there is a good Heavenly Father on the other side, embracing us, cheering us on, strengthening our faith. So Jesus is saying, and if an unwilling homeowner will get up in the middle of the night to fulfill the request of a rude friend, how much more will God answer your requests? If an unwilling homeowner can be coerced by friends shameless persistent into giving him what he needs, how much more will God, who is the creator of all things, who created you and created me and knows us so well, how much more will he supply his children with what we need? If a parent knows how to give good things to their children, how much more will God give great things to his people, to you and to me? If evil people know how to give good things to others, how much more will God, who is perfect, who knows all, who is so generous, will give good things to you and me? Jesus is showing us the heart of God. Jesus shows us that God is so generous, so lavish with his love and his grace, that he loves hearing our prayers, even when we don't know what to pray. Jesus is giving us a faith that says, I can go to God and ask him for whatever I need. And that it's not just about me, but it's about this community as we walk together and we grow in our prayer life and our conversation with him. Jesus shares these stories with us so that we might go to our Lord and see him not just as our Lord, but also as our Father, as a loving parent who gives good gifts to his children. So wherever you're at in your prayer life, continue to go to God. Thank him for the gift of the Holy Spirit, especially on this Pentecost Sunday, that makes our life possible. To thank him for every good gift that comes from him, that he's not holding back on you, that you're not a bother to him, you're not an inconvenience whenever you have a need or whenever someone else in your life has a need. Go to him, pray to him. He gives good things, and he's so generous with his love, with his grace, and that's the God we worship. That's the God that we adore, and we thank him. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us pray. Lord, we come before you this morning, and we thank you so much for the gift of prayer. We thank you that you sent your son Jesus to show us how to pray and to give us a prayer, Lord, that when we're at a loss for words, that we can at least pray, Our Father, and go to you, Lord, because you give good things. Lord, when we struggle seeing your hand at work in our lives, when we struggle to see how generous you are, Lord, open our eyes, strengthen our faith, deepen our convictions, Lord, that you are our God, that you are our good Father, Lord, and that you give good things to those around us. Lord, on this Memorial Day weekend, we especially remember those who lost their lives so that we can enjoy the freedoms that we have today. Lord, be with their friends and their loved ones. We pray that you would surround them with peace and with hope in the resurrection of all flesh. Lord, we thank you for the gift of baptisms, for the baptisms and new life you're creating in Iris this morning and in two others later today. Lord, we pray for their family and for their sponsors that you would continue to follow through and help them to be able to raise their children to glorify you and to honor you. And Lord, all these prayers and so much more that weighs on our heart, we go to you, Lord, in the prayer that your Son taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Friends, we have a couple of announcements this morning before we close out our service. First, in preparation for the annual Voters Assembly that's coming up on June 7th, Pastor Dan and Beth Kerber will lead a Q&A session on Wednesday, May 31st at 7 p.m. in the chapel to address the financial operating plan for 2023 and 2024. And then please join us for our annual Voters Assembly congregational meeting on Wednesday, June 7th at 7 p.m. in the chapel to approve the 2023-2024 fiscal year budget and the election of two new members to the Gloria Day Board of Directors. And I invite Audrey to come up and talk about our middle school mission trip.
In July, we have 24 signed up right now to head to Gatlinburg, Tennessee, and there's more spots open. So if you know a middle schooler who wants to come along with us, we have a bus and we want to fill it. And so some exciting things happening this summer with youth and serving all throughout the nation.
Thank you, Audrey. Friends, please rise for our benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give to you his peace. Amen.